After all the legal challenges, the protests, the anger, this decision by the Supreme Court now seems to settle the legal argument once and for all. Here's President Trump.
Did you consider that the final word, sir?
Well, I think it's pretty much the final word. It's Supreme Court. You know, we went up and we'd win it, we'd lose it. We just waited for the Supreme Court. Yeah, that's the final word. That's the Supreme Court.
So, Omar, for Muslim Americans, what is that final word? What are they hearing after this decision?
Well, Muslim Americans and advocates on all sides of this issue don't think that this is the end. And the reason is that the Supreme Court actually focused much of its decision on the INA, the Immigration and Nationality Act. And in that act, it does delegate some authority to the president and has an anti-discrimination clause, but the Supreme Court interpreted that clause only to apply to visa issuance and not admissibility. So Congress, if it decided, could say, actually, that's not what we meant, and we're going to amend the act. So there is still challenges that could happen through advocacy on Capitol Hill, and the Supreme Court remanded it back to the lower courts given this new standard. So there could be further challenges there, and the community is not deterred.
Okay, Sean, not over yet. We could still see legal challenges. What do you say?
Well, now you know why Omar teaches at USC. It's a good breakdown. We have an executive for a reason, and their primary duty, in my view, is really for protection of the nation state. And so the Constitution very clearly gives the primary authority for those that enter the country, if it's a security basis, to the president, not to Congress, not to the courts. And the Supreme Court has clarified that. This is not just important for Donald Trump, it's for any future president, past presidents. We had the same issue in World War II during the period of fighting, the challenge was communism. We weren't taking a lot of people from China, East Germany, or Czechoslovakia, or Russia. So it's a normal course, and it keeps changing. In other words, the ban that was applicable even 2 years ago is now changing today. There's other hot spots that we may not want to have a whole bunch of people that are unvetted coming to this country. Some of the other countries may be stabilized. Iran, probably not for a long time.
Not for a while. Compared to what we saw when the first travel ban, the first executive order came out, in that first week of the Trump administration, there seems almost a muted response. There's all the protests internationally. There's almost this acceptance that this is just how it is. Why is there not the same level of outrage? You say there are still legal challenges to come, but there almost does seem to be an acceptance that this is how it will be.
Well, no doubt this is a disappointment. When you have the Supreme Court abdicating its authority to review the president and the executive when making religious discrimination, blatantly calling for complete and total shutdown of Muslims, there's going to be a muted response. So there'll be some time of regathering, regrouping, and figuring out to do what's next. But that's not to say that advocates are not still ready to keep this fight going forward and to bring new challenges on many of these issues, including the family separation issue, because this really is part of a larger strategy to reduce legal immigration in this country. Not, the president likes to talk about illegal immigration, but what's not being talked about is the deliberate reduction of legal immigration into this country.
Yeah, and Sean, we heard the president earlier talk about this decision being a win for the Constitution. This is the same president who wants to deny the constitutional rights to undocumented immigrants here when it comes to due process. This is a president who constantly chafes at the whole concept of the rule of law.
I very much disagree, John.
He said he was a very pleasant fellow.
But let me tell you why I disagree. Somebody comes into the country without permission, without papers, without documentation, has zero constitutional rights.
That's actually wrong. They do have constitutional rights. They do have rights to due process.
That may be very much of a court fiction, but it's actually a court decision. I know, but court fiction is what I said. But and that should be challenged as well. So there's activities. That immigration's the greatest controversy because it hasn't been acted on in Congress by a long time. We're still operating under laws that might have been applicable 50 years ago. Does need to be reformed, and I think everybody agrees with that.
But it's still the law now, right? Yeah.
Who knows what the law is? It keeps changing.
No, it's easy to find out what the law is, right? I mean, the law right now is that illegals are going to have greater rights than Americans? No, they have similar rights.
And not only that, the U.S. court in the Padilla case about 10 years ago said that even in criminal prosecutions, non-citizens have due process rights, and they actually have a right to affirmative immigration advice in their criminal proceedings. So not only do they have due process, they have a right to public defenders in that. So
and
they do
and
have,
they're getting that.
They're
getting that at our expense.
For Donald Trump.
Not even a thank you note.
Donald Trump continues to insist the travel ban is all about border security.
We have to be tough and we have to be safe and we have to be secure. At a minimum, we have to make sure that we vet people coming into the country. We know who's coming in. We know where they're coming from. We just have to know who's coming here.
You know, Sean, given the administration's history of vetting nominees for senior government positions, kind of makes a bit of a mockery of Donald Trump's call for vetting and extreme vetting of those coming into the country.
It's been pretty good 95% of the time. You can find a couple of the bad apples. Look, the truth is that the great controversy about child separation from the parents started with Obama. They did it, you know, without any opposition from the left, no controversy, no noise at all, except from a few Mexican-American organizations. They called Obama one pint the deporter-in-chief, and so there was some resistance. But now the Trump's doing the same thing that Jay Johnson, who was just the outgoing Homeland Security chief, just said three days ago on a national television network that, well, that's what we did. It wasn't pleasant, but we don't believe in catch and release. So he just sounds like he'd be very comfortable in a Trump administration.
Omar, explain why the situation in 2014 under President Obama was completely different to the situation in 2018 under President Trump.
Well, in 2014, immigrants' right advocates did bring legal challenges against the Obama administration and actually won in court. There was a 2015 ruling that interpreted the Flores Agreement that said children could not be detained over 20 days. So the Obama administration was held accountable in court. So this is something that has been going on through multiple iterations. But what the Obama administration decided is that a policy of family separation was unpalatable, that it couldn't be implemented, that it would be harmful for the children. And so they did alternative programs that either kept people monitoring until they have their court dates. There was an increase in asylum applications and processing, which has all been shut down now. So what the Trump administration is doing is actually taking policies that were considered and considered not able to be implemented at that time and saying, you know what, we're going to do it anyway and we don't care what anyone thinks about it.
And also at the time there was a surge of undocumented immigrants and unaccompanied kids in 2014 coming from Central and South America. I mean, if you look at the numbers, they surged in 2014. 2017, they were at record lows. But we shall move on. Just over a year ago, President Trump tweeted this. The Justice Department should have stayed with the original travel ban, not the watered-down, politically correct version they submitted to SC Supreme Court. So, Sean, is this a politically correct, watered-down version of the travel ban?
Well, it sounds like Trump is at war with his own administration, and that's oftentimes true with a president. You have, you know, millions of employees. They're not all going to agree with you. But Trump appointed the people that are making these decisions, and he's going along with it. Sometimes, obviously not happy. He's an A to B kind of guy. He doesn't believe in the process. He wants to get things done. That's part of his charm, and that's also part of the peril. He's very, very impatient. He's impatient with his own advisors, but he's not firing the people as quickly as we thought. We thought, you know, General Kelly was going to be fired. Well, he's still there. We thought all kinds of, you know, Jeff Sessions would be fired. He's still there. So Trump is learning, and some of us don't want to hear that. He's learning to become president.
Okay, because back in 2015, back in December, 2015 as a candidate, he caused quite the controversy when he made this call.
Donald J. Trump is calling for a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States until our country's representatives can figure out what the hell is going on.
Omar, you know, there's a belief now that the president will feel emboldened, he'll feel empowered by this decision. Could you see the possibility of that original sort of Muslim ban, or a version of it, at least the administration attempting to put that in place?
Well, and that's what the Supreme Court did today in its decision is give the president an ability to go beyond what he's currently done. He said, look, when you say national security, we're going to stop. And that, I think that was the wrong decision. We have the First Amendment and we have the Establishment Clause to have a higher level of scrutiny on the president. And this is not only problematic for President Trump, but future presidents. What the Supreme Court did was give a roadmap for President Trump and future presidents on how to evade judicial review. You can say what you want. You can say you have a complete shutdown of Muslims into this country. Make your policy and then sanitize it after the fact and say, actually, it was because of national security, and then you're going to get rubber stamped by the Supreme Court.
It could be Muslims today, it could be Jews tomorrow, it could be Israelis. You just don't know where this is going.
The sky's off.
Could be Koreans.
That would be a serious international catastrophe. Now, my wife's Korean American. The key is this. This is a decision that's not changing the world. It's a fairly innocuous, it's fairly minor, but something that makes a majority constitutional sense. Somebody's got to make a decision if there's a national threat from other countries and making decisions that may be arbitrary, it may be unfair. Congress can change it. That's why we have Congress in the first place. So we have checks and balances. Okay. The good news is the sky's not going to fall, the sun's going to rise in the morning, and we're going
to
have breakfast.
Very quickly, I want to finish with the Republican Speaker of the House, Paul Ryan, calling out Democrat Congresswoman Maxine Waters, because on Monday, she was the one who said that those who oppose the Trump administration should push back wherever they see members of the cabinet. They should protest and they should let them know about their displeasure. Yeah. Here's Speaker Ryan chastising Ms. Waters.
There's no place for this. She obviously should apologize. When we in this democracy are suggesting that because we disagree with people on political views, on policy views, on philosophical views, that we should resort to violence and harassment and intimidation, that's dangerous for our society. It's dangerous for our democracy. She should apologize, and there's just no place for that in our public discourse.
Now, Omar, clearly Ryan just returned from a year and a half on Mars. I mean, for him to go after Waters, given the tone which is set by the U.S. president, seems kind of ironic.
Well, and the president was the one that asked for Russian hackers to hack the Clinton campaign and the DNC. So for the Republican Party and for the speaker and the leader of the Republican Party to chastise Maxine Waters in this way, and by the way, she didn't ask for violence of anybody. She asked for persistent protest wherever you find them. Nonviolent protest is hypocritical at best and undermined at worst.
Sean, you're going to get the last word.
I'm going to get the last word. Nobody at this table, in the studio, or anywhere in Los Angeles, except in Maxine Waters, Beverly Hills home, that's not even in the district, believes that she's a rational person, not inciting violence. And she's the best gift that Republicans have had. And the other reason is that Paul Ryan, we need to have him as Speaker. He's so rational, he's so direct, he's so good, he's so clean.
And you've been on Mars with him for like the last year.
By the way, he's just a good example of what a typical Republican looks like.
Okay, thank you.
And thanks.
Thank you, Sean. Thank you, Omar. Appreciate it.